My name's Tara. I have narcolepsy type 1. I was diagnosed 5 years ago. At the age of 22, but I had symptoms since I was 2 years old. I've just become passionate about sharing my story and advocating because it took me so long, and I always felt like something was off growing up, but I didn't know what. I just graduated last year with my associate's degree in the electroneurodiagnostic technology program, and I'm an EEG tech. And I do stuff just with patient advocacy, but I'll talk more after Haley introduced herself too, but I didn't have a lot of support growing up and even in early diagnosis. And so, I can relate to this topic really well because a lot of these things that we'll talk about is things I wish my family and friends knew when I was growing up and when I was first diagnosed.
Hello, my name is Haley and I have IH. I was diagnosed in December of 2017, but my medical journey has been quite a roller coaster. I was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes when I was 8 years old, and growing up, with all the changes in your body, everything was attributed to either diabetes, stress, anxiety, depression, all of what we hear very commonly. Post-diagnosis was right after I got diagnosed, I was a freshman in college trying to navigate everything that comes with that and a new sleep disorder. And I did not do very well advocating for myself and educating others around me what IH was. More so in the last few years, I've been able to communicate my needs better to my family, my spouse, my friends, the more I learn about myself. So I'm excited to talk about this today.
I think we'll maybe talk about some things we wish our supporters knew just briefly, and then open it up for questions that you guys may have, and ask us anything you want. But so kind of like I mentioned before, growing up, it was hard. I was misdiagnosed with so many things like ADHD, ODD, anxiety, and depression. And it got to the point where my parents thought I was faking it and told me I was lazy and that it was in my head and I was using it as an excuse. I felt alone, really. And it wasn't until I found the online support groups that I was like, wow, I'm not alone. But I wish my family knew back then that, like, I can't control this and that, like, it's not like I wish I was tired all the time. I would much rather be doing things like a normal teenager rather than just sleep, but stuff like that. And just like them, my parents in the past would say, you're never gonna have a normal job if you just sleep all the time. And like saying stuff like that is not supportive. And I mean, part of it, like, they didn't know, and like, it was new to them. My sister, she's older than me, and she never had any health issues or anything. And so I think it's just important that people, like supporters, like what I wish they knew is that I'm trying my best, and I really have to put myself first. And it's not always easy, but just boundaries is super important. And for my supporters to respect my boundaries. But that's a little bit, but I'll let Haley kind of talk a little bit.
So, as I said, this has been newer for me. I think I unintentionally masked what I was feeling, what I was experiencing, for my own sake, but also I didn't want anybody to worry. So when things kind of got really stressful and everything happening in life, I hit a wall and burned out really bad. I hit one of the worst flares of my entire life, actually within the last couple months. So this was kind of the first time a lot of people were seeing me not as they had prior. You know, I appeared to, you know, be really functioning pretty well throughout the day. I graduated with my undergraduate and went on and graduated with my master's, and great. But they didn't see the things that happened outside of the classroom, outside of literally not seeing my face. I think the biggest thing is, if there were something I could do to fix it, I would fix it. And sometimes it's the best thing for me is to just have a listening ear. Not, okay, let's fix it. It's just hear me. And then I will say one more personal experience and then open it up to questions, because that's what we're hoping for. When it comes to my partner, we have been together for 6 years. We have done a lot of distance in our relationship, so that has been a little bit challenging too. So even with him, I felt I masked a lot of things. So we finally just moved, found a house together. We're in the same house. But a lot of the things we were just having to do in the summer times, then he would leave, I needed help with now. I was already burnt out. I was not able to do it all. Even though I really wanted to, I couldn't. So the way I communicated that was, listen, this is stuff I usually do, but I need to not have to ask you to help me do this all the time. If you could just do it, that would be fantastic. So that's just a little bit about kind of what I'm actually currently going through. So if you've got any questions, let us know.
Go ahead.
Could you talk a little bit more about boundaries and what you meant by that?
So for the people online, the question was to talk about boundaries more and what I meant by that. It was not easy at first to set boundaries. I was always trying to please everybody, and like people would say, like, well, you're just using it as an excuse. And I was like, no, I just literally can't. Like, I have to. And like for boundaries, I know my limits, and like I have to not overdo it. And for my parents and family and even friends, some relationships I had to cut off because for some things, like, they weren't supportive or they just weren't willing to understand and or try to understand and learn. This was mainly, my friends. I don't have many close friends besides people I've met online. Like, people I grew up with don't talk to anybody anymore, because like it was just too much stress to just have that negativity in my life, and it would make my symptoms worse. And so as hard as it is, and like I have had to do it to some families, like not necessarily cut them out completely, but just limit my time with them, and just kind of tell them, like, this is how it has to be. And it's not easy for supporters to see, like, where we're coming from, because it's like we are trying our best, but then also having to explain ourselves over and over and over and over again, and they just aren't willing to accept it or understand. And it's like, I just don't have the energy for that relationship anymore. And so a lot of times I've had to do that. And I just am very cautious now about who I let closely, like, into my life. I don't know, do you have anything on boundaries at all? Or
I think when you have a sleep disorder, like IH or narcolepsy, you have limits. You can ignore those limits or you can accept them and try your best to cope and manage and find ways to participate in those things that are most meaningful to your life. So if I could go into an event, an activity, whatever it may be, and I say, listen, if I need to step away, I'm struggling today. If I step away, please don't call attention to it. Like, I'm okay. And then this isn't a real scenario, but in this case, you know, I do step away and then something happens. Like, it's just, it's a lot. When it comes to, like, the way people are constantly questioning, I think there are different ways to do that. It's not usually out of ill intent either. I'm trying to formulate my thoughts in a coherent way.
Brain fog.
Let me come back to you. I just, that is, my brain went blank. Yeah. So I'll come back to you.
That happens to me too.
Yeah.
Any other questions? For me, so for people online, the question was if we had any advice on how to explain our sleep disorders to other people. For me, what I have found was helpful was that something actually Julie Flagar has said in the past, and she has said that think of it like you're trying to stay up for 3 days straight. And then still try to stay awake. And that's how we feel every single day. And I know people who, their spouses and family members who actually tried it. They actually tried to stay awake for 3 days and then stay awake more. And they're like, wow, I actually know what you are experiencing. So kind of like that, but then also just, I've gotten to the point, like at the beginning when I was diagnosed, I was explaining myself all the time. And kind of now I've gotten to the point where that's exhausting. It really is. And so I kind of just say, this is the way I have to do it. And if it may be differently, but, and it may take more time, but I think the best thing, like, I think that, and then also having supporters read, like, Julie Flagar's book or other books or listen to podcasts, read articles. My parents read Julie's book, and then they were a lot more understanding. So, like, just stuff like that, because hearing it in other people's words or seeing, like, that other people, like, a different version, and then they're not, like, just thinking, I'm the only person. And so I think that is what's helped me the most, but it doesn't work for everybody. But I don't know, Haley, do you have anything?
Yeah, something I find myself saying a lot is, most days, it feels like I didn't sleep at all. Some days, it doesn't feel like I slept for 3, 4, 5 days. And it's a lot harder to function those days. I think what is hard to keep in mind as someone with a sleep disorder is as frustrating and exhausting as it can be to have to consistently explain yourself, it can be extremely hard for us to fully comprehend everything that is in that sleep disorder. So then our supporters and loved ones who don't have it, it's that much harder. So yes, do I think you should have to be the one explaining everything all the time? No. That's exhausting. There are so many resources. There are people sharing YouTube videos telling their story. There are social media pages of people telling their story. There are, there's just so many handouts, whatever it is you feel most is meaningful to you and represents you, sharing that with the people you love and saying, if you have questions, please ask. But this is, here's some information about my sleep disorder. Yeah.
I wanted to add one more thing that she made me think of is also some of the online support groups that I've been in and facilitated in the past. Like, some people have their supporters come and just listen and ask questions, and it's helped a lot of people. I mean, it's not for everybody, but that's another option too. We had another question. Yeah.
I'm well versed in that.
Yeah. For people online, the question was, how do you know when to step in to help and support when that person with the sleep disorder doesn't know or want to ask for help? I'll talk a little bit, but I know Haley has a lot too. I mean, it is hard because a lot of times we don't want to ask for help. We don't want to have to ask for help. And I think definitely at the beginning when I was diagnosed was the hardest time to ask for help. I was just like still learning about it myself and didn't want to be a burden. And I mean, now that I've advocated for myself more and done more patient advocacy work and have learned from other people with sleep disorders, I think I am, like, I live alone, so I'm completely by myself. I moved across the country to Maine all by myself, and I don't know anybody in Maine. So, like, my parents, my relationship with my parents actually has gotten a lot better since I moved because they respect my boundaries more. But they ask me, like, how are you doing? And, like, just simple things, like, even just to start with, just asking simple things, how are you doing? Or if you notice that they're struggling with something, just not necessarily do it for them, but just see if you can help them out. I mean, there's no good way to know for sure when, because I also feel like for me, it changes. Like, there's times where I'm like, don't ask, like, don't help me. Like, I need to do it by myself. But then there's other times where I wish they would ask, like, be willing to help. But like I said, I know Haley has a lot more thoughts on this part.
I'm going to start off saying that I am and have always been stubbornly independent. I will do something regardless of how hard or it makes me feel. It is a consistent thing that I work to improve on because I recognize I do not need to do that. How did I get to that point? Experience. Life. I think as a supporter, it's hard when they don't recognize they should or could ask for help. But approaching a conversation and saying, you know, I want to do whatever I can to help you in X, Y, and Z, or in whatever way you need. Don't hesitate to bring up something if it comes up, or like, you can ask them, you know? But that could also be annoying to us. Not annoying. That's, but just, it'd be like, okay then. But just keep asking.
So I think what you're driving at with your question is, when you aren't ready to ask for help, how do I get someone else to notice I need help? Or when you're not ready to ask for help because you feel like you're a burden, how do I get them to notice this and be proactive? And as a supporter myself, my wife has IH, the answer is, I can't read your mind.
Yeah.
You have to ask. But the important part for the supporters and the people being supported is to have that relationship where it's not a burden to ask. The supporter needs to understand you're not asking because you're lazy. You're not asking because you want to ask. You want to do these things yourself. You want to be independent and a normal human, right? You want to have all the energy and be able to do all the things. That's what you truly want. And you're not trying to impose on them because you like to see them dance or you like to see them, you know, puppet master on a string. It's about, I need support, I need help. And you have to have that communication between the two partners and be partners. You have your own special pluses in the relationship, just like they do. And in that moment, they have wakefulness and you don't. And so you need to borrow some of their wakefulness. And it's a partnership. You're there to do it together. Let's be together and do this together. So it's one of the hardest things in a relationship that all of us will get there as we age, right? At some point, we're going to be too old to do things by ourselves. That's just the function of life, unfortunately. Many of us get to do that later in life. Many of us don't. I think the vast majority of the people at this conference don't get to wait until their golden years to have to help each other to do silly things. But that's really the hard part is having that relationship and being able to establish that small amount of communication. I know when she looks at me and says, hey, can you take the dog out to go hurry? It's not because she doesn't want to. It's because she can't.
Mm. Absolutely. I think one thing I will note is that a partner relationship versus a parent relationship is tricky too. it's a parent or caregiver, whoever you're living with, if it isn't a romantic relationship, it can be a little bit more tough for them as a supporter to come to us when we're not ready to admit we may need help with something. But just every once in a while checking in and seeing, I think, is really the best way.
I wanted to add something because I thought of it when they were talking, but because haven't been in a relationship since being diagnosed, because I've just kind of become independent and I'm picky, but I dealt with my parents growing up, and I think it's harder with parents because I don't want to have to depend on my parents. I want to be independent, and I think also parents want to help as much as they can because they care, and so it's hard, but I think the best thing is, it maybe if they say no to your help, now, don't not ask again in the future. They may change their answer. Because I know for me, like Haley said, I was very stubborn, and I was like, yeah, no, don't help me. No, don't even ask. But my parents did ask later on, and I was like, yeah, please help. So I think that's just one important thing that I wanted to add.
I just want to say with a parent-child relationship, I find that it's really important that my supporter, my parent, helps in a way that fosters my independence. Because I am strong-willed, stubborn, and I love my independence. And even though I'm super tired and exhausted, I don't want somebody to be doing everything for me, taking care of me all the time. I want to do things myself too. So it's really important that supporters help in a way that also fosters our independence. Like, for example, if we're going somewhere, my mom will always ask, she doesn't just assume, do you want to drive or do you want me to drive? And even little things like that, it's like, oh yes, I may be really sleepy and whatnot, but it's still in my field. I still get that choice and that independence to make that decision on whether or not I'm able to drive.
She asked if, like, what advice do you have for parents who have kids with IH or sleep disorders that get annoyed by not asking or asking for help? But I mean, for me, that was me. I was the annoyed one by my parents. And I say, like, I think they could have maybe approached it differently. And by saying, like, instead of asking, are you okay? Like, asking, is there anything I can do to help? And that way I can say, like, yes, no, like, and then, like, if I say yes, then say, like, what can I help with? Like, and that doesn't always work, but I found that, like, if they would have approached it that way, that would have really made me less annoyed.
We unfortunately have to wrap it up. If there are any further questions for either of us, I mean, we'd love to talk to you if you came up to us out in the hallway, or just wherever we are. But yes, thank you guys for coming. It's hard to navigate that type of relationship as a supporter, to know what to do, what's best. But talk to your people.
Mm-hmm. For the online people, she asked if there's one thing that we each want or like wish our supporters knew that would be helpful. For me, I would say I guess I'll let Haley go first because I need to think. Like, there's a lot of things, but.
They listen. They ask questions.
I think listen, and then also just, I think, like, just respect boundaries. I've learned that's a huge thing. And if people aren't respecting my boundaries, I've kind of cut them out of my life. And it's hard, but it makes my symptoms a lot better because I'm not having that negative energy and having to continue to explain myself, but...